it's such a blessing to be able to be anywhere after you get diagnosed with lung cancer. 6.5 years ago, I was diagnosed with non-small cell lung cancer and went through treatment that was chemo and surgery. And I had no evidence of disease and started getting connected with other lung cancer groups and started hearing about biomarkers and such and started pushing my doctor, not getting the information I needed or I wanted. I push, and eventually after about 2 years, ended up at a second opinion. The second opinion doctor's one that told me I had a KRAS. And I swore if I knew what it was, I wanted to connect with other people so that we can all learn what this means and how we can make it better to live with KRAS cancers. And we need to take KRAS and turn it into an acronym for knowledge plus research plus advocacy equals survivorship. So we're all here together to kick cancer's KRAS. So I'm delighted to be here tonight. This is all about the hope that we've learned over the past couple of years. And I'm going to just be tickled to death to actually introduce you to our two speakers this evening. First up, we have, Estelamari Rodriguez, right? Is a hematologist-oncologist at Sylvester Comprehensive Cancer Center, the University of Miami Health System. And she specializes in early detection and treatment of lung cancer. Okay, and we also have with us Dr. Jason Porter. And you're a hematologist-oncologist at the West Cancer Center Research Institute in Memphis, Tennessee. He's the director of the Lung Cancer Disease Research Group and specializes in treating patients with molecularly altered lung cancers and lung cancers with no actionable driver mutations. Okay, we've got a lot of ground to cover, and we certainly could be spending hours discussing all the things that is that we have to say. So let's just kind of like just dive right in. Okay, Dr. Porter, if you just kind of like go over super high level, what are the different types of lung cancer that there are?
Okay, so, you know, when somebody is new in my clinic and I'm telling them about lung cancer, I basically divide it. Because they want to know, do I have the really bad one or the one that's not so bad? Most people have heard that small cell lung cancer is more aggressive. And so that's kind of what's in the back of people's minds. So do I have that one or non-small cell lung cancer? And basically what it means is when we look under the microscope, how does it look? Is it big or is it small? The cells, the individual cancer cells. And so non-small cell is the same thing as saying large cell or cells that aren't as small under the microscope. And we look and we divide that into basically three large categories. There's a non-squamous, there's a squamous, and then there's large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma. And then outside of those three, there's some other rare histologies that we don't see quite as often, but those are the more common ones. And then the small cells, we call small cell when we look under the microscope, and they're little bitty blue, you know, round cells. So when we look at adenocarcinoma, this is the most common type of lung cancer and the most common non-small cell lung cancer. And then it's squamous cell carcinoma. And then the large cell neuroendocrine is a different type of tumor. When we look on the patient's body, the airways, hopefully you can see my chest here if you're looking. The airway is here, the trachea, and then it breaks off to left and right lung. Squamous cells line the epithelium. That's the type of tissue that we see in the upper airway. So this is where we're more likely to see squamous cell carcinoma. And then the adenocarcinomas happen more peripherally in the lung fields. So that's the difference in where we actually see those tumors. And then small cells can pretty much happen anywhere. So those are pretty much the basic types of lung cancer and how I describe them for my patients. I hope that makes sense.
Yeah, it definitely does. Okay, and then Dr. Rodriguez, if you could kind of go over what the different sorts of like biomarkers there are, like that was real high level. Now let's kind of drill down a little bit into the genomics of this.
Yeah, that's a great question because, you know, when I started my training and I'm not that old, we really only knew about lung cancer that was like you mentioned, Dr. Porter, that was like the non-small cell, the small cell and how we looked on the microscope. But now we really need to dig deeper into the genes that cause the cancer because we have today 10 biomarker-driven treatments for specific types of cancer. So we know that a lot of these genes, mutations, oncogenic drivers, genes that cause cancer, were first described in adenocarcinoma, but they can be seen in any there's mutations in any type of cancer. And I think if you have a diagnosis of advanced lung cancer and now even earlier stages of lung cancer, it is important that not only do you get a biopsy so that you understand what the histology, how it looks on the microscope, but that you get that test about the genes that cause the cancer. And so the biomarkers are those genes that we have discovered are driving cancer, and that at least 10 of those we have been successful as identifying, although a lot of them have been seen in adenocarcinoma. And initially they were first described in never smokers. We see them on people who have smoked a long time, who stopped smoking a long time ago. So it really has nothing to do with smoking history. It has nothing to do with gender. It just has to do with the cancer. So, and it's a part of the information that is critical to get at the beginning of the treatment so that you can pick the best treatment for the patient. So a patient that gets started without that information may not be started on the right treatment. So that's why it's important to do that test. It is usually ordered in the tumor specimen, or it could also be ordered what they call liquid biopsy through your blood, a blood test.
Okay, and that's a good starting point. Is there a difference of what comes back liquid compared to like a biopsy of your lung?
So the gold standard, what we think we most likely are to find the source of the genes is going to be the tumor. But many times when you do a biopsy, you get part of the tumor that is very necrotic, like dead tissue, and the actual DNA inside that tumor is not good enough to get all the information that you need, and you actually learn more from the blood. Now, the other thing can happen. You can have a blood test that's completely negative in terms of actionable mutations, but there's a lot in the tumor specimen. So a lot of centers, and mine included, we try to do, if we can, both tests at the same time, because they both can be complementary. And they are specific, some mutations, especially like RNA fusions that we're learning about, not gene mutations, but sometimes two genes coming together. And those new proteins, sometimes you can identify through the blood. And the blood test, we have a lot of blood, so we can get that in the office and get results in 7 to 10 days. So it's been really a technology that has allowed us to treat patients faster with the right treatment that we didn't have available like 10 years ago.
Right. Okay. Now, what are the most common types of biomarkers in the lung cancer, Dr. Porter?
So, you know, a long time ago, we found EGFR as a biomarker, and then we have also the KRAS mutation. But we found KRAS actually a long time ago, and for such a long time, couldn't target it. It can serve as number one, a biomarker that we can use to target for treatment, and then also a prognostic biomarker that kind of gives us some information about how a tumor may behave. So we have both prognostic and diagnostic biomarkers outside of KRAS as well. So we also have PD-1 and PD-L1, which is a protein that we can study to kind of give us an idea about how our immune checkpoint therapies may work when we treat non-small cell lung cancer. And then we also have BRAF, and we have ALK and ROS1 and all of these different proteins that may be, as Dr. Rodriguez already alluded to, driving the cancer or just giving us information on how that different cancers may respond to treatment. What's really interesting is that we used to associate these biomarkers that were drivers with non-smoking. And now we have drivers that are actually associated with smoking. And so testing biomarkers is becoming very important for all patients, regardless of their smoking history. And so BRAF is one of those biomarkers that we can see present in smokers, as well as KRAS, which we talked about. And then MET exon 14 is another biomarker that's also an actionable biomarker that we can target in therapy that may be associated with smoking. And so we've now discovered that basically we need to do biomarker testing in all our lung cancer. And obviously we know that's very important.
Okay. And so Dr. Rodriguez, are all the KRAS and EGFRs the same? Is it's like either you're KRAS, EGFR or not?
You know, the world has become more complex as the technology has allowed us to really dig in. It's almost like an alphabet of different mutations that are in each of these genes. So for example, EGFR, the more common mutations are deletion 19 or exon 21 changes. But even when you look at that whole protein, there's a lot of insertions and atypical mutations that before we used to kind of ignore because we didn't identify them very commonly and we didn't think that they mattered, but they do matter. They actually, now we have drugs developed, for example, for EGFR20 insertion, which is something that was there all along unrecognized, and those patients were not responding to the traditional treatments for EGFR because they had a different type of configuration of that protein that allowed, they needed a different type of drug to work. The same thing with KRAS, you know, there's a lot of KRAS mutations and it can be a whole alphabet of different KRAS mutations. We do know that KRAS G12C, that is a bigger proportion of those KRAS mutations, has two newly approved targeted therapies that we can offer those patients that have that KRAS G12C. But we also see patients that have other types of cancer of the colon and the lung, other parts of the body that do share these KRAS mutations, and they may be of a different variety. And because they're all different, we're gonna, the work that's left to do and where we have to invest in research is to really define what's gonna be the best treatment for each of these parts of the mutation that the patient is encountering.
I know that we just kind of came out of the big annual World Lung Conference. I wasn't there. Dr. Rodriguez, do you want to tell us some of the excitement that happened around KRAS or EGFR and or?
I'll cover EGFR, which I'm a little bit more familiar, but I think what is happening is that there's, we are two things are happening. We're getting more data of patients that have been treated for a long time in whatever option we had, like for example, osimertinib, which is the first drug that is used for EGFR. And then we're learning that people progressed. And what the next question is how can we avoid the prevention? How can we treat those resistant clones earlier? So some of the exciting data that came out was example, FLAURA2, which is a trial that used the same backbone of osimertinib, which is the targeted therapy that we use for most patients, and added chemotherapy. And the question was, would patients do better if they have that proper targeted therapy along with chemo? Will they be able to decrease the burden of disease and be managed better to prevent resistant clones in the future? That's one of the theories. And I was surprised, happily surprised, that it made a big difference. Like I always used to think that osimertinib works very well. You get a lot of responses. And then when it stops working, you can try chemo and then you have that to try. But I didn't expect that those patients will have almost 9 months of improvement in disease in terms of like they were relapsing. They were less likely to relapse if they were getting chemotherapy up front. And then with that same concept of making the treatment up front more aggressive, there were other antibody drug conjugates that were presented, and we're going to see a lot of exciting data with these new drugs that bind a receptor and kind of inject chemotherapy into cells. So for the EGFR space, we saw a trial that is called the HERTHENA trial that used patritumab, which is an antibody to HER3, which is another antibody similar to EGFR, kind of in the same space. And it basically would inject chemotherapy to those cells that have become resistant. We saw data for that, and there'll be trials adding that antibody drug conjugate to the first line therapy. We also saw the Mariposa trial, which is a drug that is approved for EGFR20 insertion, trying to use that drug, which is an antibody type drug, trying to use that drug upfront with an EGFR inhibitor called lazertinib. So there's a lot of excitement about combining drugs, not really sitting back and waiting for things to happen, but like trying to be more proactive. But the data that was kind of more mature was this FLAURA2 trial in EGFR.
Okay. All right. And then how about as far as KRAS is concerned, Dr. Porter, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no problem. So KRAS, as I talked about earlier, is a very interesting biomarker because we've known about it for such a long time. And one of the clinical trials in KRAS is CRYSTAL-1 clinical trial. So first to say, we have two drugs that are approved right now by the FDA in second-line use for KRAS G12C, and that is sotorasib and adagrasib. And so CRYSTAL-1 clinical trial is one that was a phase 1-2 clinical trial of patients with different tumor types that had KRAS G12C. Mutations, and the non-small cell lung cancer cohort was included there. And so we have the data from the Crystal One that continues to mature. And we see response rates of around 35% in a Crystal One cohort non-small cell lung cancer. And these, again, were patients with both smoking and non-smoking histories, mostly male patients. But as that data continues to mature, particularly in non-small cell lung cancer, it's now been FDA approved for use in the second line after patients progressed on an immune therapy-based treatment. So an immune therapy plus or minus chemotherapy. And so very interesting to see that, as Dr. Rodriguez alluded to with the FLAURA2 trial, where we're adding chemotherapy to these targeted therapies, and what's the tolerability going to look like, and is it really going to cause benefit? Likely in KRAS G12C targeting in clinical trials, we have further study with adagrasib, particularly with the trial Crystal 17, which is looking to add chemotherapy to adagrasib plus or minus, with an immune checkpoint inhibitor. And so it's just becoming a much more robust combination of therapies in the more advanced setting for the KRAS G12C patients, where we're familiar with the fact that the KRAS G12C patients are more likely to be smokers. And so they're probably having other co-mutations that may additionally be driving the tumor outside of KRAS G12C. So this is where it becomes particularly interesting for me to see the addition of chemotherapy to the KRAS G12C inhibitor, so that we are covering clones or parts of the cancer that are not actually being driven by the KRAS G12C mutation. And so it will hopefully increase not only the outcomes for those patients, but the response rates will hopefully be higher, as we see with the EGFR inhibitor plus chemotherapy, and then the duration of response and survival for those patients. So starting out with sotorasib and adagrasib, now approved in second line, and then adding chemo and immune therapy to those drugs in more advanced settings upfront to hopefully improve outcomes, durations of response, and survival for those patients.
Okay. And so what I'm hearing you guys say is essentially, it's not like I only have one biomarker and then this is what I have and this is, and just that's it. There's a little bit more to it. So whether it's a PD-L1, I have a biomarker, there may be a biomarker that comes on down further or not as a result of like treatments or what have you, but that makes a difference. Am I tracking with you?
Absolutely. I think it makes a huge difference. In the case of, you know, EGFR, as Dr. Rodriguez talked about, more likely to be just that one single biomarker that we need to focus on and maximize response and benefit from targeting that pathway. But when it comes to KRAS, we know that there can be so many other drivers along with it. And it's essentially, when I think about it, I think about like, okay, if this patient were a smoker, or if they had had environmental exposures, they won't have one single driver. They may have other basically carcinogenic consequences from being exposed to cancer-causing agents like that we have in smoking or the environment like radon. So more than one gene may be affected, as opposed to these single gene-driven tumors like EGFR and ALK and ROS1.
Yeah, I mean, I think the other thing that has become clear to me is that, you know, patients need to empower themselves with this information. And there have been many cases that I have seen a second opinion, or patients that I have gotten to know that the information was there, it just wasn't acknowledged. So like they had a test earlier on in their disease and it was kind of ignored because it wasn't what the doctor was doing at the time. Like either the patient went to surgery and they had a KRAS G12C mutation and that wasn't recognized, or the patient had chemotherapy, immunotherapy, and then that was kind of not acknowledged. And then the patient missed an opportunity to get a treatment earlier on that we know can work. So, you know, that's another part of this that I think it's an understanding that the science moves and there's new options and new combinations, but that you can't make any decisions until you have the information in front of you.